Dear guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this magnificent concert hall. But of course, the pandemic brings its own flavors to an event like this, so it's very important that I explain the rules. We have to wear our masks at all times, apart from the people who are speaking at the podium. We should kindly also remain in our seats. And at the end of the ceremony, our hosts will guide you out of the concert hall, row by row, to make sure that we all leave in a very safe manner. So please now take a few moments to get yourselves ready, turn off your mobile phones, as our opening ceremony is about to begin. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, dear students, this is the first opening ceremony for our rector, our new rector, Mrs. Federica Mogherini, and it is my pleasure now to hand over to our president, Mr. Herman Van Rompuy.
Mr. President, Madam Rector, Mr. Mayor, Mr. Governor, professors, dear students, dear friends. The choice of a patron for an academic year is always delicate. Last year and this year, it's about people who have resisted dictatorship and totalitarianism. Hannah Arendt, main intellectual, Mario Soares in the praxis of politics. No humanism without freedom. And Europe remains or should remain the fatherland of freedom and democracy, now more than ever. Democracy is not self-evident. It needs to be defended again, even in the West. It is a great honor for the college that President Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa has come to Bruges to pay tribute to his illustrious predecessor, who played such a major role in the Carnation Revolution of 1974 and who led Portugal into the European Union, so that a return to authoritarianism was not possible. Mario Soares also turned the page of the colonial past, as Belgium did 15 years earlier. It made our country smaller in size, but it also made us more consistent in the importance we attach to the freedom of nations. Today, we see that some global actors are stuck in a nostalgia for times of yesterday that will never come back. Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, the famous Lisbon music, the Fado, is full of melancholy, but not nostalgia. The melancholy is a more personal and complex feeling. Portugal had a proud history as a maritime nation. And that's why the president must feel at home in Bruges. That was a trading power in its own right at the time. For 8 centuries, Portugal's borders have not changed, although it has been occupied like my country. But eternal Portugal was preserved. Mr. President, the Portuguese people respect you a lot. They love you. And this was also the case with your predecessor, who is the patron of this promotion of young people, who here in Bruges will become European citizens, who love our continent, its culture, its way of life, and its ability to always reinvent itself. There is no nostalgia here in Europe for the imperialist players who have made this continent a battlefield. We now live on the wide plain of peace and prosperity, which must be conquered again and again. The caravan of the European Union is moving on, even through those difficult times. And we will only overcome this corona crisis by practicing the value, the virtue of solidarity. Each of us is responsible for our fellow human beings. The virus punishes the lack of humanity. We will only avoid new pandemics if we can reverse climate change for the better, because there is a close link between pandemic and climate. Climate also depends on people, such as the pandemic. History is the work of people. In the midst of a crisis, we must always keep the long-term view in mind. As Portuguese seafarers and explorers have always stared at the horizon so well portrayed in Belém, in Lisbon, by the monument of the Patrão dos Descobrimentos, the patron of discoveries. Mr. President, we welcome you again, and we also look forward, and this evening, we look forward to listen to you. We look forward to your speech. Thank you so much.
Mr. President of Portugal, Mrs. Federica Mogherini, Rector of the College of Europe, Mr. Herman Van Rompuy, President of the Administrative Council of the College of Europe, dear Mr. Karel de Kalooy, Governor of the Province of West Flanders, dear students and professors, I bid you all a very warm welcome to the beautiful city of Bruges. I am honored to be present here at the 71st opening ceremony of the academic year of the College of Europe. Thank you for your coming to our city during these trying times. In our lifetime, we have never seen such a pandemic on a worldwide level. It is a time when we have to keep our heads cool without losing sight of how serious the COVID crisis really is. It is also a time when working together is very important. These are not times to be divided. We all know that working together is not always easy, but it brings us to the best results. As mayor of Bruges, I was and still am very proud of the solidarity between the people of Bruges during this crisis. From the very beginning, people started to create online groups where others could ask for help. Restaurants took part in the project Feed the Nurses, and one of our hotels even opened its doors to homeless people. A warm and social Bruges is one of the pillars of our city council. We believe that connection is the basic condition of a warm community. Bruges has always been an inviting city, which embraces diversity and which welcomes people from near and far. Did you know that the name Bruges refers to the old Scandinavian word brygga, which means a harbor? Today, Bruges has kept its welcoming spirit, and it is still one of the world's main ports. Already during the Middle Ages, our city attracted tradespeople from far and wide. Bruges was a real melting pot of different nationalities. Thanks to our many canals and our easy access to the sea, we became one of the biggest trading centers in the world. The 15th century truly was Bruges' golden ages. The Dukes of Burgundy settled into the city, and the Flemish primitives such as Jan van Eyck and Hans Memling found the creative hotspot they needed in Bruges. However, when the court of Burgundy left Bruges, the international tradesmen also disappeared. Years of war followed, and in the middle of the 19th century, Bruges was a poor city. Luckily for us, the tide started turning after the writer George Rodenbach wrote his book Bruges la Morte. In this book, he describes Bruges as a somewhat sleepy and mysterious place, enough to attract the curiosity of our very first tourists. To this day, tourism is of great importance to our city. Bruges is also a student city, which welcomes many students from abroad each year. The presence of the College of Europe has been a privilege to Bruges since 1949. It is the place where Europe's leaders of tomorrow are created, and it brings strong personalities to Bruges who play an important role in Europe. And that is you, dear students. Many of you will achieve great things within Europe. I have already talked about the importance of working together. Many people count on you to find solutions to the external and international challenges within the European Union. It is up to you, to your generation, to prove that the European Union can face these challenges. And your journey starts right here in Bruges. You are the new inhabitants of our city. And you are here during a special time. The students who came before you got to know Bruges before the Corona crisis. You will get to know Bruges in a different light. Since last week, the measurements to beat the coronavirus have become stricter. In Belgium and many other countries, there has been a rise in positive cases. The College of Europe has not been spared of infections. 46 out of 350 students tested positive for Corona. In the past, there have also been some incidents with some students of the College of Europe. Incidents where the measurements were not followed at all. This was very unfortunate. Luckily, as at last week, all students who were tested positive have now tested negative. Congratulations. However, I want to strongly encourage you to keep being careful. Don't take risks and protect yourself and those around you. As I said, the measurements have become stricter in the entire country. We can only have 3 very close contacts. These are the people who we can hug. Apart from that, you can see 4 other people, but with these people, you have to be careful. Keep your distance and wear a mask. You also have to wear your mask in all our shops, in the most busy streets of Bruges and around our railway station. I said that you are the new inhabitants of our city. And at the end of your stay in Bruges, you will receive an official document which will give you the title of Bruggeling Honoris Causa. I wish you an inspiring time here with new friendships and relations. Know that you will always be welcome in Bruges. When you leave, I hope that you will be able to look back upon your time in our city with great joy. And who knows, maybe you will even decide to stay here. Whatever you choose to do, do it with pride, respect, and compassion. Lastly, I want to congratulate your new rector, Federica Mogherini. She is the successor of former rector Jörg Monar, and also the first female rector of the College of Europe. So you can say that her appointment is a real milestone in the history of the college. I am looking forward to a new fruitful cooperation between the college and the city of Bruges. Thank you very much.
De paz e de estabilidade no mundo conturbado dos nossos dias.
Mário Soares is the patron of the College of Europe in the academic year of 2020-2021. Born in 1924, Mário Soares was a fundamental political figure of Portugal's transition to democracy after the April Revolution in 1974, decisively shaping the history of Portugal and Europe. A lawyer and professor, Mário Soares stood against the dictatorship of the Estado Novo, was arrested a dozen times, deported and exiled. Founder and Secretary General of the Portuguese Socialist Party, Vice President of the Socialist International, Minister, Prime Minister, and President of the Portuguese Republic. He was also a member of the European Parliament and President of the European Movement, Chairman of the Committee of Wise Persons of the Council of Europe, the Committee for the World Water Contract, and the Commission on Religious Freedom. He was also the mentor of the Independent World Commission on the Oceans. With a solid humanist background, he defined himself as a republican, socialist, secular, Portuguese, Europeanist, and citizen of the world. His life was a constant and persistent fight for the values and causes he believed in, among which the defense of freedom and democracy was foremost. After the 1974's April Revolution, Mário Soares started, formally in 1977, and led the process of Portugal's accession to the European Economic Communities. In 1985, also as a Prime Minister, he signed Portugal's Treaty of Accession to the European Communities, which he understood as an indispensable step for the integration of Portugal in an extended space of freedom and development.
Um futuro que desejamos solidário e de unidade.
Mário Soares left us a vast political work, reflecting on the issues that shape the world, pointing out paths, warning about dangers, voicing disapproval, expressing hope, and encouraging dialogues. Mário Soares has always been a great European thinker. In the last years of his life, he prevented and alerted with extreme lucidity for the dangers overshadowing the European project, reinforcing the importance of remaining true to its founding ideals, especially the need for solidarity between its members in the construction of an extended space of freedom and social development. Here's to Mário Soares, Portuguese, humanist, Europeanist, builder of the European Union.
Dear Mr. President, Mr. President, Mr. Governor, Mr. Mayor, let me start with a special thanks to you, and if I can, a special personal thanks to the Mayor of Bruges for having made this possible. Chers étudiants, c'est avec un sentiment d'émotion profonde que je m'adresse à vous ce soir pour la cérémonie d'ouverture de l'année académique de la promotion Mario Soares. C'est votre promotion, c'est votre chance de vivre une expérience unique, inoubliable, qui va vous accompagner pour le reste de votre vie. Et pour moi, c'est ma première promotion, qui va aussi rester pour toujours dans mon cœur. Mais il y a une autre raison spéciale pour laquelle nous partageons ici, dans cette salle magnifique, ce soir, un sentiment d'émotion. Et c'est lié à la présence du président du Portugal, Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa, qui nous fait l'honneur d'être ici avec nous, dans un moment si difficile pour tous nos pays, pour l'Europe et le monde entier. Et je veux le remercier énormément pour ça, au nom du Collège et de vous tous. Merci, Monsieur le Président. Before I give the floor to the President for his keynote speech, let me introduce our patron de promotion, Mario Soares. That needs no introduction, but still I was explaining this is my role tonight. And for once you will not me here saying something about COVID. I subscribe every single word that the mayor did, so for tonight I will not mention the word COVID. But I will come back tomorrow on this. The man, Mario Soares, the politician, the fighter, the winner, the hero of Portuguese democracy and freedom that has spent all his energy and talent from his very early years in university to put an end to dictatorship, but also to prevent the radicalization of the revolution, and then to bring his country into the European integration process. Ready to pay the price of unconventional revolutionary choices with prison, deportation, exile. Ready to restart the fight every time, even when the difficulties appeared immense. Always guided by his values that for him, historian, lawyer, were the constant and creative update of the fundamental principles of humanism. Freedom, equality, justice, pluralism, human rights, peace and international cooperation. He has been founder and secretary general of the Portuguese Socialist Party, vice president of the Social International, with strong political and personal ties with leaders like François Mitterrand, Olof Palme, Willy Brandt, just to mention a few, a great generation. He has been Minister of Foreign Affairs, Prime Minister, President. He has been the engine of the 3Ds policy of his country: democratization, decolonization, development. He signed the request of accession to, at the time, European communities in 1977, and then concluded himself the negotiations, signing the accession treaty in 1985. He understood that bringing Portugal into the European integration process was the best way to guarantee that democracy and freedom became irreversible achievements for his country and his people. And at the same time, he never stopped fighting for democracy and freedom also in Europe. For him, being a convinced European and being critical towards the shortcomings of the European integration project were not contradicting elements, on the contrary. Being a proud European implied for him the constant search for a better Europe. Member of the European Parliament from 1999 to 2004, President of the European Movement International, he has always believed in and worked for a Europe of values and solidarity. An idealist, constantly aspiring to a better future for his country, Europe, and the world. And yet, a realist, extremely aware of the conditions needed to put in place the changes he was dreaming of. If you allow me to use Gramsci's words, that for sure he would have used, he had the pessimism of reason and the optimism of the will, or rather, I would say, because he was definitely not a pessimist, the lucidity of reason and the determination of the will. His wife writes that in 1975, when the revolution that put an end to dictatorship was turning into a radicalization that was very far away from the dreams of democracy and freedom that had animated Soares and with him many others, during those months, she used to tell him every morning that the situation was not the one they had been fighting for all their lives, and that she was really desperate. And she writes that he replied, "No, we are still fighting, and we are winning." And indeed, they won, because they never gave up, with lucidity, determination, and hope. There is an anecdote that helps understanding the personality of Mario Soares more than 1,000 words. And we have tonight the privilege of listening to this very short story in the words of a great Portuguese, a great European, a citizen of the world, for me also a good friend, that knew Mario Soares well and that has accepted immediately our invitation to share with us his memories of him. It is a pleasure for me to introduce to you the message that Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of the United Nations and former Prime Minister of Portugal, has addressed to you, to the opening ceremony of the Mario Soares promotion of the College of Europe.
Dear Federica Mogherini, dear students and faculty members of the Collège d'Europe, it is a pleasure to say a few words to you about my countryman Mario Soares, a great public servant, political leader, and European. Mario Soares was instrumental in establishing democracy, freedom, and respect for fundamental rights in Portugal, and his legacy in my country is assured. But his vision and contribution went far beyond Portugal. Mario Soares was a proud European who believed in European values, European unity, and Europeans' role on the world stage. He saw Europe as a project of peace, prosperity, and freedom. Looking back, Portugal's integration into European institutions may seem inevitable. At the time, it was not. I was privileged to attend one particular meeting immediately after the 1974 revolution, when Mario Soares was the leader of the Portuguese Socialist Party, and he had convened several prominent economists to talk about the implications of a possible accession to the European Economic Community. The economists spoke cautiously, one after the other, talking about the serious problems and obstacles and discouraging early accession. Closing the meeting, Mario Soares told them, "No, you are wrong. Let me tell you what will happen. Portugal must join Europe, and the sooner the better." And indeed, as Prime Minister, Mario Soares steered Portugal towards entry into the European Economic Community and later signed the accession treaty. Mario Soares' beliefs were rooted in the values he pursued throughout his life, freedom and democracy. He paid the full price for those values in arrests, imprisonment, and exile when he was young. Today, we need to continue the fight for those values in Europe and around the world. And ending wars and horrific violations of human rights are forcing millions of people from their homes. Hate speech and xenophobia are on the rise. The climate crisis, growing inequalities, and the rise of digital technology create new dangers. We are now battling a global pandemic that has killed 1 million people and thrown societies and economies into turmoil. European solidarity and unity, and the Enlightenment values of rationality, tolerance, and dialogue are more important than ever. You, young Europeans, will carry the torch for Europe in the world. You have an important part to play in setting a course towards a better future. I hope you'll find inspiration in the example of Mario Soares. I know you would be honored to be remembered in this way by the Collège d'Europe. Thank you, and I wish you all the very best for your studies.
I think you are the first promotion being addressed by the Secretary General of the United Nations. Keep that in mind and make Bruges proud of you. But let me underline something that Antonio Guterres tells in this short message. He says, "Looking back, Portugal's integration into European institutions may seem inevitable. At the time, it was not." Please take a moment to focus on this sentence and what it means. Imagine the scene, imagine the economists convened by Mário Soares at the time, the mid of the 70s, cautiously advising against early accession of Portugal to the European community, and imagine Mário Soares closing the meeting by telling them that no, Portugal would have joined, and the sooner the better. Guterres always told me that there is a difference between being in power and having the power. And I am sure I had, now that I heard him telling this story, I'm sure that he had this in mind. If you are in a position to take decisions, use it. Don't waste it. Do what you think it's right. Sometimes what you believe is the right thing to do seems impossible to achieve. Sometimes it seems unreal, weird, unlikely to happen, unpopular, against the mood of your times. Sometimes everybody around you warn that you are going to fail. You are putting all your energies into a dream, a lost case. They advise to aim at something easier, more realistic, more possible. But change doesn't happen without someone that makes it happen. And that might be you. Because even the impossible can turn real. As Nelson Mandela said, it always seems impossible until it's done. To make it happen, you need the courage and the lucidity that Mário Soares had. The capacity to do not what is easier to achieve, but what you believe is right. Democracy for your country, human rights for all, the unity of Europe, overcoming colonialism. These are only some of the fights that Mário Soares chose to win. And I have no doubt that many around him, starting from those economists, had warned him about the price to pay, a very high price, and the risk of failure. Why should you go there? Why should you risk to lose? You will hit the wall. They must have told him so, and he did, indeed, hit the wall for some time, hard times. But he must have thought that the real failure would have been for him giving up to what he believed was the right thing to do, his principles, his values. And he made it. He won. With him, Portugal won and Europe won. I wish you the strength and the courage to follow what your heart and mind tell you is right. Don't ever make a step back because of fear to fail, or you will have failed already. There are fights that are worth fighting, no matter what the mood of the time is, no matter how little chances you have to make it. There are some imperative choices you have to allow yourself the luxury to make. And this is what determines who you are. Some generations live evident determining choices, and Mário Soares clearly belonged to one of those generations called to make history. But every generation has its own chance to be on the right side of history. Yours as well. Don't ever forget it. Do what is right, not what is easier. And you might one day say, as Soares does in one of the last interviews he gave, j'ai eu alors le sentiment profond de pouvoir accomplir ce qui devait être fait. Before I conclude, let me share with you a very short personal anecdote. The very first choice I was called to make as soon as I was appointed rector last spring was not choosing the patron de promotion that was already chosen and no better choice could have been made, but I had to choose the photo that would have accompanied this promotion. And after long talks, the college team and our Portuguese friends that are here with us in the room, and I thank them for being that, they came up with two options, both very telling of the personality of Mário Soares. The first one was him giving a public speech, I think in 75, with a lot of energy and even anger, Mário Soares, the fighter. And the second one is the one you see behind me, Mário Soares, the winner, smiling, confident, a very soft image. It's Mário Soares, the man, the smiling man. His daughter Isabel said of him, I quote, "He loves people. He gives everyone his personal telephone number. He talks to everyone. He is a very curious man, and he enjoys hearing funny stories. He is also a good storyteller himself. He is an ordinary man, a simple man. He loves beauty and style. He has a strong feeling for color. He knows that he has no time for that, but sometimes he becomes sentimental about it, just for a brief moment, and then it's over." That photo, I think, captures that moment, the man, the ordinary, sentimental, smiling man. And I wanted you to be accompanied this year, this difficult year, by an image of happiness and gratitude, to remind you that even in the most difficult of times, you can smile, and that a smile is not a sign of weakness, but of strength. Only if you're strong, you can afford it, and show the human being beyond the public figure. In a time when everybody seems to identify toughness with strength, that photo is there to remind you that real strength doesn't need toughness. Real strength is based on understanding, listening, and empathy. It takes much more courage to smile sometimes than to shout louder. You can be strong and soft. You can be strong and smile. May the strength and the smile of Mário Soares accompany you during these 10 exciting, challenging, extraordinary months at the College of Europe, in Bruges and in Natolin. And from here, from the moment when you enter this unique community of the College of Europe, may your life be full of happiness, empathy, and success in accomplishing what you believe is right. Thank you.
Thank you. It's good to see that you're still clapping after 1 month I'm in office. That's very encouraging. It is now my pleasure, my honor, to introduce to you a message from our vice rector that unfortunately cannot be here. But we thought it was important, first of all, to have Natolin connected with Bruges for this special day of our opening of the academic year. So our friends and colleagues in Natolin are following the opening ceremony remotely. But Eva, our vice rector, because I think we are the only academic institution that has a woman vice rector and a woman rector, and five out of six directors of studies that are women, so I guess we will have a problem with gender balance in a while. But Eva has sent us a video message to address all the students here in Bruges for the opening of our academic year. So we'll listen to her words now.
Dear Rector Federica Mogherini, dear President Herman Van Rompuy, dear President Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa, dear Mayor Dirk Defoe, dear students of Mário Soares promotion, I am happy and grateful to take part in this ceremony and to address the newest members of the college family. I would prefer to come to Bruges campus and greet you in person, but the ongoing circumstances prevent me. An opening is rightfully an occasion to celebrate, but it is also an opportunity to reflect on the past and to think of what is on the horizon. So allow me to share with you my dreams for a greater future for our continent that can only become a reality through your passion, devotion, and innovation. We have a tendency to laud ourselves for the levels of achievement managed over the past 7 years in European politics, but there is no doubt that we have made many mistakes as well. There is prosperity, but there is also a wide inequality gap. Economies have grown at a rapid pace, but at the expense of our environment. There is peace within the Union, but there is little unity. The European Union is a beautiful, tangible reality that you experience in your daily life, that you know, live, and love. Even though this reality is beautiful, but it is still far from perfection. And it is your turn to push Europe to fulfill its potential, which cannot happen without questioning the form of integration we have reached. We need to consider the unseen borders that Schengen did not open. We need to assess the rapport between the center and the periphery. We need to address the social divisions and cultural clashes within European nations rather than among them. Because a strong union is a dynamic union of people, not only of governments. So, dear friends, Europeans, or Europeans in your hearts, let this year be an eye-opening experience during which you acquire rich knowledge, develop critical approach, but above all, dream. Dream of an everlasting solidarity among and within European nations. Dream big and see beyond for your countries, for Europe, and for the whole world. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. It is now my honor and pleasure to invite the President of Portugal, Mr. Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa, to join me on stage at distance, signing the Golden Book, and then address our students. Mr. President.
Dear Rector, dear President, dear Mayor, dear Governor, dear professors and students, all of you colleagues, because I'm a university professor, excellencies, let me start by thanking the Rector, Frederica Mogherini, for inviting me to address this prestigious college, an institution that goes back to 1949. In you, Madam Rector, I recall all those who benefited from the excellence provided in Bruges and Natuna. Allow me to highlight also the address by Herman Van Rompuy, first President of the European Council. He played an important role in the choice of this year's promotion pattern, and I thank you very much for it, on behalf of all the Portuguese. A word also to Mr. Dirk de Fau, Burgomaster of Bruges, with my recognition for his inspiring words. It's a beautiful city. One of the things I missed in my life is not having studied here in Bruges. What a pity. I'm too old to restart my life. But I should at the end of the presidency. And to Mr. Karl de Kauwe, governor of the West Flanders province, that really very wise personality, chose to have a second home in Portugal. Another one to the Portuguese commissioner is over there. And I think also some Portuguese members of the European Parliament. Thank you all for your presence and remarkable service to Portugal and Europe. An example of how important is for us Portuguese, the European Parliament, is the fact that two MPs and a former MP are presidential candidates for the elections of January 21. My second word is for you, dear students. There is a legend about the College of Europe. It's a life-changing experience. When I was 79, I visited as university professor. The Portuguese, there were 10 students of the Paul-Henri Spaak promotion, the first one after the accession of Portugal to the then European communities. I was impressed by this college's very special atmosphere and strong identity. Here, questions matter more than answers, preparing you for the future. But beyond your own, it is the future of our common home, Europe, that you bear in your hands. You are the hope of generations to break the damaging concept that the European Union is just an idea of the so-called elite. It is not. It must not be. It must be a shared project of peace and prosperity and social justice, a token of human values and dignity. You are, you'll be, the ambassadors of such a token. My third word is for the professors. What a superb job you do. You are also the key to the success of this college. Let me finally address you, dear Federica Mogherini. What a start. What a start. You are already popular before being popular. Having been Europe's voice in the world, you embody the spirit of a college created after the Second World War to prepare young people to a new era of economic and social progress, security, and peace. All the best for you, as the Italians say, brava. You are brava. Dear students and very soon colleagues, your patron this year is not the first Portuguese, but the second ever chosen by this prestigious college. The first in 57, a long, long time ago, when there was still the French, the Belgium, and the Portuguese colonial empires, was Prince Henry the Navigator that led at the end of the 14th and beginning of the 15th century the adventure of crossing the seas, not the Mediterranean Sea, but the Atlantic, the Indic, and the Pacific Oceans. Henry the Navigator, son of a Portuguese king and of an English duchess, is a symbol of modern ages, although the oceans and globalization remained endless challenges. Mário Soares is a symbol of contemporary age, someone that saw in the 40s and 50s of last century how Portugal, Europe, and the world would evolve. The College of Europe could not have made a better choice. As a person, he was a fighter. He was a brave fighter. He was a passionate fighter. One of his motto was simple: only those who give up fighting are defeated. He never gave up fighting. His life was an example of that motto. Young communist, founder of the Socialist Party, strong opponent to the dictatorship for 3.5 decades, so many times deported, in jail and in exile, himself and his wife, until the revolution of the 5th of April, 74. when he returned to Portugal in a train called Freedom, thinking that Europe was Portuguese destiny. Fighter during the revolution against all kinds of dictatorships, military, civilians, coming from both far right or far left or far left. Prime Minister that signed in 77 the accession of Portugal to the then European communities. First civilian elected President of the Republic with universal vote and re-elected with more than 71% of votes and a repeatable achievement for a unique personality. But more, much more important than his personal qualities, cleverness, culture, intuition, empathy, openness, knowledge of human nature, visionary understanding of humanity, moral and physical courage, were his values, those he never ceased fighting for. Freedom, human rights, democracy, democratic socialism, and Europe. Opening this same ceremony, the 3rd October 77, Mário Soares justified the demand for accession presented 6 months earlier as follows, in French, as it was declared. L'adhésion est ainsi, pour nous, l'indispensable saut qualitatif qui construira à la fois un solide rempart pour nos institutions récemment établies et la voie irréversible pour un destin que nous voulons partager. And it is so inspiring, his continuous fight for these values today, the 13th of October 2020, at a decisive moment in the world and in Europe. He fought for freedom, for human rights, for democracy. And freedom, human rights, democracy are at stake today in the world, but also in Europe. The crisis in so many party systems, or in so many social and economic partners, in nowadays mediatic and inorganic democracies, the incapacity of change in the so-called catch-all parties, then cartel parties, the emergency of new issues, new challenges, new media, and also new social, economic, cultural needs and unfulfilled dreams paved the path towards so-called populisms and illiberal democracies. In a sense, like 100 years ago, it is the weakness, the failure, the lack of belief, but also the lack of response to popular, legitimate expectations that create the ambiance for anti-systemic, selfish, xenophobic movements, parties, and leaders. It is our fault. It is no use blaming the newcomers for what they receive as a gift from the outdated, incompetent, feeble movements, parties, and leaders of a vanishing time. Mário Soares never gave up in his fight for social justice, in his democratic socialism vision of politics and economics, and also fight for social cohesion. Social justice and social cohesion are at stake today in the world, but also in Europe. The pandemic we are still living in showed us how much we needed a health European Union. The economic and social crisis we are wanting to overcome through recovery and resilience plan and financial multi-annual framework asks us short-term measures involving social cohesion action against increased and unbearable poverty, inequalities and asymmetries, but asks us much more than that. Structural changes, green and digital transition, reindustrialization, different approaches to economy and society, and refusal of all kind of non-transparent and corrupted institutions. Otherwise, we, Europeans, shall miss a key opportunity to lead in all those domains, and will deepen the cleavages that weaken us and weaken each one of our democracies. Mário Soares was, until he left us, a vibrant European. Europe, for him, was not only the essential reason why Portugal and we Portuguese built a stable and long-lasting democracy, but an irreplaceable power in the complex geopolitical world context. Mário Soares lived throughout his life, in his intense way, the fall of bipolarism, the impossible rise of a perfect or then even imperfect unipolarism. And recently, nowadays, this unpredictable mixture of multipolarism without multilateralism, emergent new bipolarism, and eruption of unilateralism and protectionism. In this so awkward combination, so many global dramatic challenges, climate change, war, hunger, migrations, refugees, healthcare, education, women empowerment, face anti-multilateralism, suspicions against international institutions, defiance against international law, altogether with unilateralism and protectionism. With the new bipolar system slowly emerging from the very trade and political war, no longer the bipolar system of last century. As the Eastern Pole is converting itself into a regional power, no longer a global power. Anyway, with large influence in Europe, Near and Middle East, Mediterranean, Northern and Central Africa, strong in cyber and political influence, less strong in an economic long-term sustainability for a decisive military power. But a regional power that never forgets and never forgives the downgrading caused by geopolitical evolution. And another Eastern Pole making a slow twist from a regional power into a global one, and from economic expansion into an intelligence and geopolitical one. Europe, it was one of Mário Soares' deepest convictions and worries, should be the prospective power able to balance the world, to predict, to act in preemptive missions, to anticipate, to break the deadlocks, to affirm the values that make the difference between oppression and liberty, ignorance and knowledge, human dignity and contemporary forms of slavery. Together with our traditional allies, such as United Kingdom and United States of America, even when they hesitate in choosing their allies or being consistent in their commitments. And we do want a post-Brexit agreement and an effective, humanistic, democratic, transatlantic alliance. Dear Rector, dear professors, dear students, other Portuguese professors, students, guest speakers came to this House of Culture and gave us their testimony about freedom, human rights, democracy, social justice in Europe. José Manuel Durão Barroso, just invested President of the European Commission, delivered the opening lecture in November 2004 for the Montesquieu promotion. Prime Minister António Costa was here, opening the Simone Weil promotion in 2017,
And he recalls it in a very grateful way. He was telling me today, by phone, of course, well, I never forgot this experience in the College of Europe. And Antonio Guterres, a long-lasting friend of the 60s and 70s, came here as Prime Minister and back again as Secretary General of the United Nations, as he did today, to speak of someone he got to know very, very well, as I did, as our generation did, Mário Soares. Antonio Guterres, who is fighting every day for the need of multilateralism at the time of so many disillusions and disappointments of so many billions of citizens around the world. Even now, during the pandemic, with the half-truth, the savage struggle for sanitary materials and equipments, the non-cooperative actions, and the egoistic attempts of using vaccines as weapons of political competition. It would be ridiculous were it not signs of behaviors we cannot accept. Mário Soares would never, ever accept it. That is why he could easily understand what Hannah Arendt, last year's promotion patron, once wrote. Out of solidarity, men and women would establish a community of interest with the oppressed. That is why he dreamed of a free Portugal in a strong and united Europe, not an Europe where the fundamentals are forgotten just for the sake of short-term conveniences. That is why his legacy will be a landmark for our presidency of the European Council next January the 1st. A presidency implementing next generation EU, working for quicker recovery, stronger resilience, universal European presence, dialogue with Africa, India, Mercosur, social summit, and most of all, desire of closing the gap between European institutions, European politicians, and European citizens. That is why Mário Soares was, is, and will be so inspiring for you too, dear students. And now I stop for a while to tell you how moving this ceremony is. Moving because we are living still a pandemic period. Moving because you know all the difficulties you had to face, we have to face all over Europe, all over the world. Moving, it is my first opening ceremony this year. Tomorrow will be the second one in Coimbra, our oldest university with 730 years of life, but just with 60 or 70 persons, and only a few students. It's moving to see you here. It's moving to see the new rector starting this way. It's moving to see that we want and we shall overcome this period, so difficult period, psychologically, socially, economically, politically, for every family, for every one of us, for every one of you. Well, looking at you, having been university professor for 46 years, I do understand what you're feeling at the age of 20, 22, 25, 28, 30. One is a dreamer, an impatient dreamer, a potential activist, wanting to change, to innovate, to break through, to fight for values, to fight for people of flesh and bones, to make a new world happen, to make a strong and leading Europe happen. As Ursula von der Leyen said in her speech in the European Parliament and repeated in the Portuguese Council of State 2 weeks ago, in what we all expect will be a new European cycle to shape a better way of living for the world of tomorrow. That's her saying. If you really want to be future and a much better future, Mário Soares is a very, very inspiring pattern. That is also why, dear rector, dear students and professors, it was a privilege for me to deliver this opening address to the 2020-2021 promotion, the Mari Swartz promotion. For once, I felt many, many decades younger. Thank you.
Say obrigado. It was indeed a moving speech, a la hauteur d'un moving moment, because I think we all feel emotional about the fact that we are finally in one room together. It is a special moment, and you captured it perfectly well. Thank you, Mr. President. And now it is my pleasure and honor, because the ceremony is not over yet, to give the floor, last but not least at all, to your voice. Because one of you, one of the students' representatives, will now address us all with a short message. And I can only imagine how emotional she might feel in this moment. So please, without making you wait even further, Sophia Seber, please come on stage.
Dear President, Rector, Excellencies, fellow students in Bruges and Natalie. Je veux commencer par l'histoire d'une femme qui me fait sentir vraiment européenne et qui m'a inspirée à venir au collège. Vous connaissez peut-être son nom grâce au bâtiment principal du Parlement européen à Strasbourg, Louise Weiss. Elle était infirmière, journaliste et militante française pour les droits des femmes et l'intégration européenne. En 1979, à l'âge de 86 ans, elle a été élue au Parlement européen. Et elle était vraiment une grand-mère de l'Europe, comme l'appelait Helmut Schmidt, l'ancien chancelier allemand. En tant qu'européenne convaincue, elle a appelé les peuples d'Europe à être unis non seulement par intérêts économiques communs, mais aussi sur la base d'une culture commune. And it is this common culture we would like to focus on today. Because this common culture and the interest in Europe is the reason why we, 343 students in Bruges and 134 students in Natelin, are here together at the College of Europe. I would hereby like to greet our fellow students in Natelin. We hope that we will get the chance to meet you in person this year. During the past 1.5 months, we have experienced so much together. We have grown so close, especially emotionally, much closer than without a global pandemic. We have literally taken care of each other while being in quarantine or isolation. We brought each other food, and we ran to the pharmacy or in the supermarket. Some of us have been in quarantine for 3 weeks or even longer. And I think I speak for everyone here when I say that you're not alone. We are not just providing each other with food, but we are providing each other with psychological support. We are all in this together. We have been standing together, we've had online quizzes, workouts, and dinners, and we will continue to stand together in the future. So if you think about it, we have already created some sort of common culture while being in quarantine or isolation. When we were in quarantine for 2 weeks, going to the student restaurant at Garemarkt was what we were looking forward to all day. Not because of the food, although we would like to thank the chef here for his efforts, but because we were able to be outside and see other people. Yes, it was the same work for 14 days, but hey, at least we could get some fresh air and a glance of our fellow students behind their masks. So what does this show us? It shows us that we came here to get to know people. We came here to make friends. And although this was rather difficult until now, we still have the whole year ahead of us. Which again brings me back to the topic of common culture. A common culture in your new normal. Until now, this year has not lived up to the expectations of a normal year at the College of Europe, as we, for instance, could only have a very small circle of contact, and we could not travel around freely. However, I would say that among all the places that we could be in right now, the College of Europe is the best place to be. We do see each other every day, and we know that we have our friends in the residences that would help us no matter the circumstances. Imagine being in a small apartment in a big European city with only online lessons, all alone without your fellow students. At the college, we still live, eat, and study together. Yes, we did have 2 weeks of quarantine, but we waved at everyone we saw in Garemarkt, and now we do even have several classes in person again. So as cliché as this may sound, we will be the ones who went through Corona together. And in 20 years from now, you will still be friends with your quarantine buddy. So moving from Garemarkt to the future of Europe. Mr. President, we would like to thank you to have come here under the circumstances of a global pandemic to share your ideas on Europe with us. Obrigada. I believe we all came here because we wish to shape Europe's future. Climate change, Brexit, and the economic downturn, only some of the challenges the EU is facing nowadays. I came to the college thinking that all students will have the same views, but that's not true at all. We all wonder what Europe will look like in the future and what purpose the EU will have. We don't know. What I have learned from the conversations here with fellow students is that there are many different answers to these questions. Depending on the background, these can vary quite a lot. But isn't this the beauty of the college, that all these ideas come together in a melting pot? In 1 year, we will have a much bigger understanding of other views and cultures than 1 month ago. And that, although we wear masks all the time. Europe will not be held back by quarantine. Europe needs to be inspired by new ideas. Even the founding fathers and mothers did not know what the EU will look like in 2020 when they created the European Steel and Coal Community. Because Europe is a process that has still not stopped. We are still in it. And it is the common culture that we create here that will help Europe grow forward in its process. The EU will probably not look the same in 10 years, but that's not a bad thing. We are constantly shaping it to make it better, whatever this means to each and every one of us. So again, I would like to refer to Louisa Weiss. We need to create a Europe in which we're unified, not only because of shared economic interests, but because of the European values that define our common culture. This is why we came here. We want to make a Europe where people feel like they belong.
just realized that probably before I spoke with a mask, we're getting so much used to it. Thank you, Sophia. I think your words made us all realize that indeed you have had probably the most difficult start of any promotion ever, but also that you showed already, after only a few weeks here, an incredible amount of solidarity and capacity to take care of each other. And I'm sure this will be the most solid basis for you all to have a wonderful 10 months here in Bruges and in Natolin for our friends that are following from Warsaw. It is now my honor, and I'm very emotional about this, it is now my honor to declare officially opened the academic year 2020-2021. Congratulations to our wonderful music, to all our special guests, to all of you. I think this is the end of it. but please bring the joy of Europe in your heart and remember, and I say this on my behalf, on the Mayo's behalf, no parties, neither tonight nor in the future. Have a nice evening. Thank you.
I kindly ask everyone to remain seated, and the concert hall hostesses will make sure that everybody leaves the concert hall safely this evening. Thank you. Voilà, tot eerst de goede moment.
Merci.